Game and Fish and with the Landowner Relations Program coordinating funding for conservation projects.
I'm Ron Tiller. I'm with the Arizona Department of Environmental Quality, County College.
I'm Anthony Juarez. I'm with Arizona Game and Fish. I'm in the Birds Program out of our Phoenix office.
Carol Beardmore, retired Fish and Wildlife Service. This would have been my fourth furlough. And I work with Edwin a lot on effectiveness monitoring, using birds as effectiveness monitoring, and we're here to learn more about freshmen working with various different treatments.
Justin Ladd, Game and Fish, Contracts Branch.
Susan Skirvin. I work with USDA ARS on a project to quantify the effects of brush management using remote sensing.
Sage Goodwin, Guadalupe Ranch, east of Douglas, Arizona, half in New Mexico, half in Arizona.
Sarah Nelly, I'm a senior research specialist with the U of A, and I also work with the Rangelands Partnership.
Mike Kermans, Arizona, Cooperative Extension.
I'm Ashley Wright, and I'm the livestock area agent with Cooperative Extension for the southeast corner of the state.
Amy Ganguly, I'm an associate professor in the Range Science Program at New Mexico State University.
Got us already. Still there.
I'm Harold Maxwell with BKW Farms. We're under contract with Tucson Water to manage their 26,000 acres of retired farmland.
And Mark Heitlinger is our first speaker this morning. And we missed him. Are you going to introduce him soon?
I will. I'll give him the big
intro. Why? We'll roll you out.
Don't feel slighted at all, because here's the real deal.
The only important thing is that if anything doesn't work, it's my fault.
We're happy to pass that off to you. My apologies for reading from the paper, but I don't have this all quite memorized. Mark has managed the U of A Santa Rita Experimental Range since 2003. And previously, he worked for the Nature Conservancy for 18 years, where he worked in their bison and prescribed burning programs. He has a master's degree in geography from the University of Minnesota, and we're very happy to have him speak here today.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. It's really wonderful to have you here. I'm so glad you could join us today. So I'm going to talk about the history and current status of the Santa Rita Experimental Range. A couple of disclaimers. I'm not a real historian. There's a lot of material here, but I think that Barbara Hutchinson and others are going to make these slides available to you. So if you don't read everything on them, you can go back later. And true confessions, I'm in love with the Santa Rita. I'm sure it affects my objectivity in presentations like this. The history of the Santa Rita Experimental Range is closely tied to grazing in Arizona, so let's take a look at some cattle numbers. Before, or up to about 1870, according to the Ag Census, there were less than 50,000 cattle in 1870. Jumps up to 136,000 10 years later, and zooms up to almost a million 10 years after that. Then we have this bubble burst, and about a third or so of the cattle herd was gone over this 10-year period. And then it starts to recover 10 years later after 1910. Just for reference, according to the 2007 Ag Census, there were about a million cattle in Arizona, a few more, I think, in 2007, and I don't know if that's still current or not, something like that. So this chart, you'll see several times, it begins in 1880 and goes to 1910. The red bars represent the Ag Census, the U.S. Census numbers of cattle in Arizona, and the blue bars represent the tax assessor numbers. And you can use your own imagination as to why they might vary. But if not exactly correct quantitatively, at least you get a sense of the ebb and flow of cattle in the state level, I should say the territory level, in Arizona. And when we look at these same data at the county level, the tax assessor data for Pima County, including Santa Cruz, in Cochise County, Pima's in purple, we can see again that there's a sharp drop-off. In this case, in just 1 year, about 50% lower numbers according to the tax assessor. That's 1891 to 1892, July to June. So what happened to those cattle? A lot of them died, enough so that there was a whole industry in collecting cattle bones and shipping them to fertilizer plants. But I've read, in reading the history, I'll say there's a lot of confusion about how many of these cattle died, how many were otherwise disposed of, and I wouldn't take numbers you read in historical accounts too literally unless you really survey the literature broadly. Robert Forbes, whom we'll talk about more later, I think is probably one of the more authoritative writers, contemporary, and he said in the Wilcox area, the losses due to starvation were 15 to 50%. So this boom and bust of cattle helps us understand the establishment of Santa Rita and also the early thrust of researchers up here, particularly the narratives about ranching and grazing. There's one narrative that points a pretty damning finger at ranchers, such as this one by J.J. Wagoner, who basically is nicely saying that ranchers were greedy and wanted bigger and bigger herds. Nathan Sayer has done a great job of expanding this narrative to demonstrate how much of the impetus of cattle growth happened outside of the boundaries of Arizona, particularly fed by money from the eastern United States and Europe, where this was considered a safe and profitable venture. Another external factor to Arizona was that prior to the bust in Arizona, there was a bust in the Great Plains, particularly the northern Great Plains, because of blizzard and other factors. And a lot of those cattle then came to Arizona, where there was still free grass and fewer blizzards. So the drought, there's also a drought in our narrative. And as Wagner, who I mentioned earlier, says that this drought was started in 1891. And he credits that with the precipitous decline in cattle numbers. And indeed, there's perfect correspondence between the rollover of cattle numbers according to the assessor data and this this number here, which is about 70 or so percent of a normal longer range precipitation. But there were other years, these red dots, that were drier than 1891, and plus we had this wet period up here, so it's hard to say, it's really hard to look at these data, but perhaps there was this favorable period and then the drought kind of tipped things over the edge. Hard to say. The contemporary professors at the university didn't talk too much about drought. They did mention it, and they talked about cattle numbers, but they really were trying to, these early men are amazing for their insight into trying to understand range management back in those days, and also to develop administrative responses to the problem rather than oversimplifications of pointing the blame. So this is James Tomey, who was a botanist and entomologist at the U of A from 1891 to 99. He had a nice gender-inclusive lab in 1896, it's nice to see. And he wrote in 1891, this point just past the peak of cattle statewide and the very year of the decline, 1891 to 92, he wrote an article, a bulletin called Overstocking the Range. And so this is, in fact, the year of the infamous drought. And he describes the problem, he describes grasses disappearing, he describes less palatable plants coming in, but he also lays an interesting framework for a range management perspective. He has a sentence, as elsewhere, this is only true, the deterioration of the range is only true where there are more stock than the food supply will justify. So he's already talking about carrying capacity and stocking, which is kind of interesting back in 1891. And then he also gives a synopsis of the process of overgrazing. If the top be continually eaten to the ground, or even very near it, the roots will gradually become extinct. So he's providing more of an ecological, ecophysiological perspective on the process. He kind of is followed by Forbes, Robert Forbes, who came to Arizona to teach at the Ag Experiment Station in 1894. He became director later. There's a building to his honor on the campus. And so let's put him in perspective. He comes in 1894, and 8 years later, he's advocating strongly for a research range reserve. If we look at those 8 years, it's kind of interesting. He actually arrives in a drought year, drier than the 1891 year on an annual precipitation basis. And this period of 8 years is actually a pretty devastating period. The rain falls below average, and cattle numbers are pretty low. And he's coming right on the heels of this precipitous die-off or reduction, I should say, in the herd in Arizona. I wish I could give a whole lecture on Forbes. He's a fascinating guy. but he, in a series of papers, made what I think are some really brilliant early observations, tying together the ecological, hydrological, economic, and human behavior components of what he called unrestrained grazing, which is kind of cool. These other guys are mostly saying overgrazing or overstocking, and unrestrained means to me unregulated or unmanaged. So he's laying the groundwork again for what can we do in the way of managing cattle. And he connected the cattle bust to the open range grazing system, which he described as the ruinous methods inevitable upon a public range being everybody's property, nobody's care. So what is open range? Well, it's not what we know of today as open range. It's not the joke. It's the unassigned, unfenced, unreserved public government land being used by anyone with livestock, access to water, and enough influence, which may mean tough cowboys. This is a photo of the open range, as it were, in 1920, joining a fenced area on the Santa Rita. I can't verify exactly when this fence was built, but it was sometime between 1903 and 1915, as far as I can tell. The open range, according to a real historian, Rowley, created chaotic conditions in many western areas by the late 1880s and 1890s. And Forbes derided it as the open range regime, like some kind of cruel government. Forbes was, had a contemporary, this really wonderful guy from reading his stuff, named J.J. Thornburgh. Thornburgh came to the university in 1890. He was a taxonomist. He contributed over 100,000 plant specimens to the herbarium and apparently taught the first course in range management beginning 1913. And also, I take some comfort, he looks like a total nerd, which I think is delightful that he would be the first kind of real range scientist in Arizona. So here's where he arrives, 1890. Santa Rita is established in 1902, and after this 20-year traumatic period of range history, which he experienced firsthand, he then writes this amazing monograph of several hundred pages called The Grazing Ranges of Arizona. It's tough reading. He's not the best, the most skilled writer of the English language, perhaps. But here's how he describes what the open range grazing operationally looked like. He says it would be considered very poor business for a person to improve the public grazing lands so long as his neighbors could share equally with him all the advantages and none of the expense. And then these darn tramp sheepmen come in from who knows where, and their sheep eat the last mouthfuls of grass. So this is kind of coordinates with what Tomey wrote as the process of overgrazing. And Forbes especially, but also Thornburgh, I think, really understood that ranchers were just behaving kind of rationally in an irrational system. If they didn't overgraze, their neighbors would overgraze. If they did overgraze, they still had overgrazed land. So it was kind of a crazy situation, and ranchers were in this double bind, as it were. So who would save the day? Well, Teddy Roosevelt was part of it, as well as these three gentlemen that I'll mention again, Forbes. He was interested in learning how to recover this damaged rangeland and to avoid repeating the catastrophe, the boom, and especially the bust problem. He arranged to present a paper at a scientific session in Denver, the American Forestry Association, where Gifford Pinchot was also presenting. Pinchot, many of you probably know, he was probably the most important force in Washington, D.C. at the time regarding forest protection and management. And these are the two papers that they presented, subsequently published in the Journal of Forester. Forbes wrote about open range and emphasized the effects on irrigation. And coincidentally, favorable to Forbes, probably Gifford Pinchot was writing about the need to, or the process of grazing in the forest reserves. So Forbes proposed at the end of his paper that there be this new category of federal land. There should be federal reserves specifically for the proper economic and scientific study of the problems involved, in his case, in unrestrained open range grazing. And again, there's a whole lecture here, but Gifford Pinchot bought it, hook, line, and sinker. And in his the next thing that happened in this history is that poor President McKinley met his untimely death a few months into his presidency. And that's important to Santa Rita because that propelled Theodore Roosevelt into the presidency, and that changed the face of North America. Forbes, in his autobiography, talks about this process Gifford Pinchot, in his autobiography, talks about Forbes' role. He credits Dr. Forbes at the university with this, suggesting this establishment of the experimental range reserve. But it wasn't to be a range reserve, at least initially. It was to be a forest reserve for various reasons, including Roosevelt's ability to sign into authorization large tracts of land to be forest reserves at the time. And you might wonder, well, forest reserve, is that really a scientific study area? Well, J.J. Thornburg writes in 1910 that at the time the Santa Rita Forest Reserve was created, its purpose was expressly understood to be the study of grazing range problems, a demonstration on a large and convincing plan of range restoration and control. I've emphasized restoration because I like to think of Forbes and Thornburg as the earliest wave of restoration ecologists, but it's also interesting that I'll bring up that term again in another slide in just a second. So Forbes and Pinchot and Roosevelt, they thought big. This red outline on a recent, more recent image, obviously, is showing the boundaries of the original Santa Rita Forest Reserve. Sonoyta's down here and Patagonia's down here, so this was an enormous tract of land. And the next president after Roosevelt, Taft, undid a certain amount of Roosevelt's work, including this large reserve. He took about 400 square miles of it, put it back in the unreserved status, and he said the forested portion would become a forest, the Santa Rita National Forest as it was named at the time, and that some 65 square miles would be reserved for something called the Santa Rita Range Reserve to improve forage production. So it's kind of interesting to me that the goals in the same year, 1910, as Thornburg was writing, he said restoration, and probably was, this may represent more the perspective of the Washington D.C. agricultural group, that we should be looking at improving forage production. And that goal of restoration, I think, kind of morphed into introduced plants and all kinds of methods, primarily oriented towards improving and building production. So we went from 1902 being a forest reserve of immense proportions, 1910 being a range reserve of 65 square miles, and by 1921 we were an experimental range, and by 1939 we had the current configuration. It was enlarged a bit from the 1910 version over the years. One of the first things that was done in 1903 actually was to build a fence. And this is a very important thing. It was probably the largest fenced out area of public lands up until that time. And it represented basically separating open range chaos from managed cattle within that, or the opportunity to manage the range because of that large fenced area. And this is, this 50 or so sections represents the oldest continuously studied and protected rangeland in the world. So it's kind of a sacred area to some of us. George Rule has pointed out, I hope I get this right, George, that when you look at these early goals of the Santa Rita and the range research that was being done, it basically represents, they didn't use these words, but we might use the words of sustainable range management, and that the Santa Rita is the birthplace of this study in arid lands. So from 1902 to 1988, the federal government managed the Santa Rita. Largely, it was, for most of that time, it was the research branch of the Forest Service. But the university kept involved. There were formal cooperative agreements. There was lots of research, cooperative extension, field trips of all kinds out here organized by the university. In 1988, the Fish and Wildlife Service wanted to establish the Buenos Aires Wildlife Refuge on state trust land. So there was a major, the parties got together and arranged for a major swap of land whereby Santa Rita became state and the Buenos Aires state land became federal. And the legislature passed a law at the time saying that the U of A would manage this area for research and education. The land itself became state trust land administered. 2003, the Pima County announced that the Santa Rita would be part of its open space lands in the Sonoran Desert Conservation Plan, and this provided kind of another layer of protection, since if the land was developed, it would have to be replaced by taxpayers. So this is the current status. The dark line represents Santa Rita as it was being mapped in the 30s and 40s and 50s, and this area here did not transfer in 1988 because it was then within the Coronado National Forest, and our headquarters is here, you're right down here now, and we use this place through a permit with the Forest Service, special use permit. Deep breath. I'm almost done. I mentioned this 50 square mile area that was fenced out in 1903. The cattle were taken off it in 1903, and they were still off in 1910 when Thornburgh wrote his Grazing Ranges of Arizona. And I want to just try to make a small contribution to the real subject matter of your workshop by telling you what Thornburgh in 1910 wrote about shrubs, especially mesquite. He distinguished upper and lower elevations divided by this 3,500-foot isoline topographic line. And in the lower elevation, he says there's, in 1910 now, after 7 years or so of fencing and no grazing, there's still practically no perennial grass growth. But he says there's abundant and nearly uniform mesquite and acacia, and then there are other species he mentions. Excuse me. In the higher elevations, he says there's fairly good growth of grass, and he comments that the trees and shrubs are found mostly along the sandy washes, which I think we'll hear again later in this morning. But he then says young mesquite plants are coming in quite thickly in this higher elevation area. And that's kind of interesting, and he gives an explanation. He says that originally they were kept out, or prior they were kept out by frequent fires, but once the open range heavy, what he calls close grazing occurred, the grazing came to play the part of a fire. And so he makes these interesting observations. He says that due to close grazing during the open range era, livestock kept mesquite in check, which is kind of an interesting contrast to other stories I read about in this time frame about the role of cattle. He says mesquite growth was abundant and nearly uniform at lower elevations. And he says that mesquite is reasserting itself in the higher elevations after 7 years or so of exclusion from cattle grazing. And it's curious that he uses the word reassertion. I haven't really found anything that sheds more light on that, but I'm struck by his use of that word. Maybe it's just sort of sloppy language, but maybe he's implying that at some time in the past, the mesquite were there and they were just reasserting themselves away from the sandy washes. I want to leave you with this. Robert Forbes wrote in 1895 in a primer that he developed to help school teachers in Arizona. He says, "We must know this primitive nature in whose lap we live if we would win her smiles," which is a lovely poetic conservation message. And so we can say back to Dr. Forbes 120 years later that thanks to continuing research by people in this room and others and this nice workshop, we're still learning. So I think I got through it, and if you have any questions, I can try to address them. Yes?
Yeah, so this tragedy of the commons that you laid out, so how about in open range conditions like in Mongolia? How do they fare in that condition?
I don't know anything about Mongolia. You may be able to answer that question better than I can. I mean, I can say that guys like, you know, J.J. Wagner, in his articles, he says that there were kind of informal agreements between ranchers to sort of protect their nearby ranges. And that is directly contradicted by other history that I read. In some places, the commons may be managed by a more communal spirit of cooperation. from what I can tell, that was largely lacking. And in particular, you read stories about large, you know, industrial, basically corporate ranching in parts of Arizona with huge herds, 40, 50, 60,000 animals, and they would just kind of run roughshod over smaller homesteaders. Forbes was particularly concerned about what he called the small man, which is kind of interesting to read that even back then these professors at the university had a real social conscience and they were really concerned about a more equitable division of resources. Okay, no other questions? I